Hey guys, Rev from Into Gaming. Gonna do a video covering the PUBG loot system in a little bit more detail. It's more of a level design video, so to speak. We're gonna be covering some of the elements in the spawning system, but we're also gonna be covering level design aspects as far as placement. And how all these things are kind of like snapped into place, and just basically cover all of that stuff, because I have questions about it. Why are weapons and loot items spawning underground? Well, there could be many reasons for it. Depends on how they set up their stuff and how they're placing their items. And as a level designer, I believe that adding spawners, these little buggers here, adding these to the world should be on the level designer to do that, as far as the flow of things. Hey, this is where I want weapons to spawn, and then configuring what can spawn at these points should still fall on the level designer. Now with PUBG, I believe there's a loot table system in place where it basically, before it spawns something, it says how many of these are already existent in the world, how many have already been spawned into the world. So it kind of keeps a loot cap on certain weapons and attachments and so forth, so there's not like 1,000 level 3 vests spawning all over the place and everybody gets a level 3 vest. So you want to have some kind of control there, but you don't want to limit your randomization and probability factors. So you will add a level 3 vest to a spawner to actually be able to spawn, but you take count of how many are in the world so that you're not spawning too many of them. Same for like M416s, QBZs, QBUs, M1684s, and so forth. You just don't want to spawn too many of them in the world. So when you run through a certain set, well, a building or two, and it's just like, okay, well, every one of these buildings, the only thing that ever freaking spawned in them was an M416. So you go through three buildings and you find 12 M416s. That's what the probability and the loot tabling system helps negate. But with my system, I don't have any of that. It's just gonna, the way that it basically works is I add a loot spawner to the ground or surface anywhere that's flat. It's got to be flat, so you don't want to have to deal with rotation because you don't know what's going to spawn. And I go through and I have tiers in mind. So tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. This is for a whole different purpose. Nothing related to PUBG in itself. And I just configure what's going to spawn. So like with this particular spawner, we're going to use this as an example. I'm guaranteeing that it's going to be an M4, AIM-1, or another gun launcher item. And that's it. I'm just flat out guaranteeing that it's going to be, actually I can state that. And right now it's guaranteed it's going to be an M4. Play it, it's an M4. An M4 spawn. Yay, got an M4. So there is the ability to come through and say, hey, this is what I definitely want to spawn here. Just by doing something like this, you would fill, in my system, you would fill all three tiers with that. Now, if I want to say, I want it to be random, but always give a weapon, I can just put, you know, these AR things in here. Some kind of a weapon. Let me actually add another one here. Let's see which one. Launcher in there. So now when I play it, there's always going to be a weapon. Always a weapon spawn. So that's one way to guarantee, and you, more than likely, you need to do this the same way in PUBG, as long as you fill it up and the max count for that particular item hasn't been met yet. So for an example, if I always wanted an M4A1 to spawn here, I would just set my system up to spawn M4A1s for that specific point, that spawner. But if this is late round, you know, we're down to the final circle kind of deal, it's late in the game, and there's already been 100 and the loot table caps off at 100, well then nothing would spawn here because the M4 has already been maxed out. But anyway, you should get the point on that. So basically, let me actually delete this one. I'm gonna make this one so it's always gonna spawn an M4A1. So this little demonstration. Now, placing spawners into the world is pretty much a drag and drop. You get your class, your blueprint class for it, and you just drag it out. Boom. Now I have a new spawner in the world, and something will spawn there as long as I configure it. That's how easy it is. Just drag and drop. You put them wherever you want. Now, sometimes when you drag and drop these things, they're not lined up perfectly. I have the grid turned off on mine. So I'm going to turn the grid back on, and we're going to drag another one and see what happens. See now, with this one, see how it's lifted up off the ground compared to this one? It's because I'm grid snapping, but the terrain isn't snapped to the grid. It can't be snapped to the grid in all angles. And I'm going to pop left in. See how this one's over here? This grid. Anything you want your for most stuff, like when you're working with BSP, you want to snap it and align it to the grid. But with static meshes, you're not going to be able to get that alignment all the time. Do it where you can, but in most cases you're not going to see this these crates over here. They're not snapped to the grid, they're aligned to the top of the terrain. I can get back out. The terrain is this grayish stuff, but get back out in perspective, and then we'll go into wireframe. And there's just a lot of polys. You see all those polys for the terrain, and you see they can get flat here. And I just want to get my actors, my spawners, I want them flat with the surface, so when anything spawns there, it's going to be touching the ground, it's not going to be floating up. So I'm going to show you that real quick. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to delete this guy, and I'm just going to turn off my grid snapping. And I'm going to take this one, I'm going to lift him up off the ground. And this is going to show the static nature of things that get spawned. If they're set to static or stationary or world or movable, they will spawn right here unless and stay there unless you apply physics. I'm going to show that real quick. It's just floating. And that looks god awful. That's why you place things on the ground. You don't want to spawn them up in the air and then have physics applied and then have the physics bring them back down to the ground, because that's adding more overhead to the server and it's adding more overhead to the client in rendering. Because now this object has physics. The other thing that you don't want to happen is you don't want players running up to something to pick it up and they kick it. Because they have a collision with the foot and it kicks the item and it's swinging it, and then they have to run to pretty much catch it. And you don't want that to happen, so you don't apply physics. So what you do is bring this bad boy down to the ground and see that crosshair here on that target. It's got the little white, and it lines up with my y-axis. I'm going to bring that down till it's in the ground a little bit, right about there. And what that's going to do, that's going to spawn it in a nice even placement. And you can see my barrels are above the ground. Some of it's below the ground, but for the majority of it, it's above ground. Let's see what else spawned in here. We got another one in here. It's laying on the floor. Nice. Everything seems to be lined up pretty good. Pull right there. Everything's just lined up like it needs to be. Now, what I wanted to show you with this is two of the things that you have to do as a designer setting this stuff up. So, the origin point, where the thing is going to spawn, the item is going to be spawned, is going to be based off the origin point of the spawner, and that's its X, Y, and Z location. You see that X, Y, and Z, and its rotation and so forth. So we're working with the location. We want that spot down here. So that's where things are going to be based off and spawned. Now, when you get into the weapons and the things that you're actually spawning, you also have to look at the static mesh and how it's aligned when you have that set up. So I'm going to go into left orthographic. And you can see it's got an origin point. I put this one off. And actually, let me open up something else that'll have a good one. I think this one's got a good one, too. The origin point on the weapons are different. And I screwed up a bunch of these so you could see the difference. See, this one is lined up dead center along this axis, but it should be technically right in the center. And this is basically the pivot point, move point in how we do alignment. So if I was to pivot this, like rotate it, it would rotate around this point right here. So you get a weird rotation instead of a dead center rotation, more along like clock hand spinning. But with this one, I made the orientation off. So, but you can see this green line here, that's going to represent that center origin point. Blue and the green here. Let me pull this up so you can see it. The blue and the green is the origin center for my spawn point. So I want the gun to be like resting here. I can bring it down to about there, because having this spawn under the ground, this portion is not a big deal. But I'm going to show you an example. If I don't have this aligned correctly, I aligned it right there. I'm going to come over here. Even though this is lined up really good where it needs to be, I'm going to eject out so we can get down in here and look at it. It's floating. And we don't want that. So we have to go back into the Emporia 1 and we bring it back down. It's a nice one. So I'm going to have the back basically touching. This is going to be touching. The barrel's going to be... Big point here is having the barrel float a little bit because it's open-ended. That'll be good right there. It's open-ended, and you don't want to see the landscape inside the barrel. It's ugly and unprofessional. But anyway, that's that. So do one more spawn on this. I'm going to eject out so we can show that. And that looks pretty good. The barrel's above ground. Most of the gun is above ground as a player looking at that. Let me see. The player looking at that looks pretty decent. I can run up to it and I'm not going to kick it, and I can grab it. You can somewhat tell it's still above ground because my foot's going underneath some aspects of it. Anyway. That's that. Placement and positioning and stuff. That's pretty much it. And then once you have all your meshes lined up, you can pretty much just drag and drop this thing and then align the little target point like I did. So as long as the meshes are lined up in the in its blueprint, in its viewport, they're lined up where they're going to, along that green, the Y axis and the X axis, they're kind of flush with it. And your spawner, your little sprite component, zoom in on this guy real quick. He's way over here. I hate this camera speed sometimes. as long as he is lined up, which he should be. Let's go over and look at the left. You see the left here? He's lined up perfectly with it. Then you're always going to have that nice little flush spawning if you're working with statics. So, pretty set there. So, rule of thumb with this, when you're actually adding these things into your world, it's basically just a drag and drop. And see, because I'm off grid, my grid, it's going to snap right to wherever I want it to go. See, it immediately just goes right in there as long as that grid's off, because my terrain and everything else is not matching Unreal Engine's default grid. It's not locked into the grid. So my plane here is not going to match up with the grid itself in a plane in a 10 centimeter increment, or even a 1 centimeter increment. Now, to show you that again, now that one lined up perfect. That one lined up perfect. I dropped this one in. He's floating. And he's floating. And we can come over here and look at the difference here. Floating. Lined up perfect. And you know, zoom out, you can see it. That's just perfect. Part of the green arrow is buried. Less of it's buried. So you're going to have a floating issue here. This one will be lined up perfect. This one will be lined up perfect. Take those out. And this one is part of my XT. Nah. Yeah, I'll keep it. So, that's the basics on that. So, we got configuring done. We got the probability and randomization aspect kind of covered. Placement and moving is kind of covered. One thing that I'm going to end up doing at the end of this is doing the whole scene move. I'm going to duplicate this whole building here, and we're going to move that over, like right over in here, and place it. And we're going to just copy all of it, the spawners and everything, lighting effects, deco, everything. And I'm going to show you how we do that at the end of this. So one other thing I wanted to get to before we jump there is adding a new item to the spawn system. So right now, as far as items, we have the ammo side. We have 5.56 and 7.62, but we don't have any 9mm. So we're going to add the 9mm to the spawn system. So I'm going to close this. Go back to the event graph for that. And I'm just going to go over into the items. These are all the items that can spawn, and they represent the static mesh version, that's the pickup and drop aspect of it. So we're going to take ammo 6, the 7.62, we're going to duplicate it, we're going to rename this one to 9mm, we're going to open it up, and we're going to go right over to the viewport, and we can still see that the static mesh here is the 7.62. But what we want to have is we want to have the 9mm. So I changed the static mesh for this component to 9mm. Now, what I also want to do is rearrange my X and Ys. The red line here represents the X axis. The green line to the right represents the Y axis. So with this, because it's square, I just like having them match up. So I'm going to get in here and I'm just going to rotate this so that you can see it right down here. My X going that way, my Y is going this way, and they're all lined up. And then I need to go over into left graphic, make sure that's straight, it's on the line, and I'm going to go to the top and make sure that that's straight. Because we're dealing with a primitive object here, it's easier to line up. And the most important thing is the bottom of this mesh meets the surface that I place it on, so it's not floating, it's not buried underground, and so forth. So that's good. I'm going to compile, I'm going to save it, and then we're going to come in here and we're going to change out a few things. So what we want to do is look through some of this ammo. I'll get that and see 9mm automatically added. Boom. That's how easy it is to add a new item into your system as far as the static mesh reference. Now, with a PUBG system, there's a lot more to it because now you have a static mesh reference that's going to be spawnable, but you need to actually associate it, bind it with the actual equipable, which is a higher poly mesh, which actually fires and shoots and all that stuff. So you would have to bind all these things to their actual, to the weapon system and the equipment system, versus just what I just did. This is just one step in the process, but for our purpose, that's how easy it is to do. So we're going to put some 9mm there. We're going to go up here and do some 9mm. Put a 9mm in this. Everybody loves 9mm. Love that 9mm. So I got it in a few places, so we should be able to get it to spawn. And it's going to be the little orange box. See that? Times. Yeah, it's just too freaking random. So what I'm gonna do? Oh no, I don't want to do that. Turn the grid off. Snap it. And we're gonna guarantee some 9mm. Good to go. We know it's spawning and it looks right. Just to verify that it looks right and it's spawning correctly. Yeah, there it is. Bam, right to the floor. Perfect. So that's that. Alright, so to conclude this, starting to be a long video here, we're gonna move the scene. We're gonna duplicate this whole room scene or this building scene, including the crates and the spawns and everything. So, first off, you'll notice over here that I have, which was this? That was my 9mm, I don't need that. Everything is organized. And for this building, everything that's a part of this building is encompassed in this folder. We have exterior elements for the crates, the spawners near the crates. Let me just expand this because I'm going to need it expanded anyway. We have the interior effects, the lighting and so forth. We have the decorations. We have the loot spawners. And we actually have the structure itself all in there. So what I need to do from here is I'm going to create a new building folder for us to move this stuff through. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through here and I'm going to select all the descendants, and that's going to select everything that's inside the building folder. Everything. So every element in this building has been selected. And you can see it, they're all highlighted. The exterior stuff, the spawners, everything's selected. And then at this point I can actually move it all and have it stick together where it's supposed to be. I'm gonna right click and then I'm going to go down to, where did it go? No, actually I'm not gonna right click. I'm gonna just Control C and then Control V. Now I've duplicated everything. You can see the duplications are highlighting yellow. So I'm going to take all of this and I'm going to shift it off to the side to get it off of this in case I accidentally click somewhere and I have all those duplications and then I would have to manually go through it. Now that I have them all moved over, I got this folder down here. I'm going to click and drag and move them all into this other folder. So now I can collapse all these other ones, which I'll have to come back and create folders. That's one thing that I wish Unreal would do, is duplicate the whole hierarchy as far as the folders and everything and have it all organized. But right now, everything that makes up this building has been duplicated over here, and everything is in this list. And I'll have to go back through eventually and do that. So I have that duplication done. Now, Giggles, I'm just going to raise it up, and I'm just going to click on its folder. And now we have a house floating up there. Now what I need to do is I need to come over here and clear out this area. So I'm not just going to drop this house on top of all this grass and stuff, because I don't want the grass to be in there coming up through the floor and so forth. And I don't want there to be any shadows or performance issues because of you've got stuff in here that's not being accounted for, because every grass item I add in here affects the light mass. So, and what I can actually put on top of the terrain, because every one of these trees and patches of grass affects the overall light mass weight. So first things first, I need to go in and go in the paint on the grass, and I need to remove the grass. So I'm just gonna zigzag through this little area here. We're gonna remove this grass. Now the area here is pretty flat for the most part. I want to make sure that it's flat, at least is, you know, in line with that. So I need to go over into the sculpting, and we'll use the flatten tool. I'm gonna bring it down a little bit, and I'm gonna find a flat spot over here. We know that this is flat, so basically I'm gonna click here and I'm gonna drag over, and it's gonna flatten it out and make everything as flat as that. And let's see, what's the flat ratio on this? That looks pretty good. And what I need to do with this tool, with its size, is I need to get an area flat enough that I can get a bigger brush. Alright, that's pretty big. Now I can scale my brush up, I can cover a bigger area faster. So this is all where this house is going to go. It needs to be flat. Terrain all flattened out. We'll come back through and tweak that after I move the house over. So get down here, make sure, yeah, that looks pretty good. Now I can go back. I can go to my building one, select all descendants. Now they're all selected, and I can move it and get some alignment on this thing. Now I gotta rotate it 180 degrees. She's all rotated now, and now I can bring her down, get her a ballpark idea of where I want it. Definitely want to go back some. Shift this back. It's a little much. Rover. I'm going to pull it a little bit closer this way. Okay, now as far as floor alignment, you always put your buildings on slabs so that you can have that depth adjustment. But I have steps on here, and I want the bottom step to align. So, see how I just clicked? That's what all that select all descendants is great for, and having your stuff in folders, it's perfect, and versus having pieces all over the place in the outliner and having to manually control click on each one of them. So good rule of thumb there. So what I want to make sure is my grid is off, because I don't want anything snapping to the grid, and I'm going to slide this down and wait. So as I go through the ground, once I touch it, you see how this line gets all kind of, it's pixelated? That kind of tells me that I'm there. just for giggles, I'm just going to run over here and do a nice quick test. Yeah, that looks like it's aligned. So now I'm aligned. I'm solid on that. Before I set everything, I just want to run around and check it. Yeah, the terrain is good there. It's all pretty good. Okay. That's done. So now I'm going to scroll up and I'm going to click on the folder again. That gets everything there. I'm going to do a geometry build. It has nothing to do with lighting. I still have 76 objects to build for lighting. That just gets that geometry set there real quick. And then I have to go back through and I'm going to smooth out the terrain. Get rid of all this. This area all smoothed out, and we have this big ugly edge here, and I'm gonna smooth this out so I don't have any of these jagged ugly edges. Now when you're working, the bigger your brush, the more area it's gonna affect, and the more intense it is. So for smaller areas, I'm going to drop down this brush a little bit. See, it's a little bit subtler effect, but I don't need subtle back there. A bit bigger. But what I don't want to happen is I don't want me to go around and touch anywhere near the house, because that'll put a dip right here, and I want my surface to be. There, I'll crease it a little bit. A little bit right through there. See, that's a pretty hard slope. So what I might do here with building, I'm going to take crates, highlight those. And I'm going to manually click on each one of these little guys. And I'm going to slide them up a little bit. We're solid there. I can go back and back into my paint. And we can get some grass back in here. Grass up in here pretty good. And then I'll shrink that back down to a smaller brush. And we can get into our little detail stuff here. Detail it out real quick. That's not. I'm subtracting the grass from the area. It makes it a little bit more natural. That's good enough for this. Add a little bit of this light dirt. Light up in there. Work. Save it. I'm going to do one more geometry build. Geometry is the quick part. Slow part is the actual lighting. Save it. Now this part takes forever, so I'm gonna have to come back after this is done. Alright, so lighting's been done. It's long-winded little build. Go through and give you a quick run on this. When you do lighting, it basically it runs through the swarm agent, which allows you to set up a network of computers to actually do the lighting build, because doing it on a single PC, it just takes forever. And it for this particular thing on a network, if I had a network set up for this to manage the task on, they could spread it across multiple PCs, then lighting wouldn't have taken but a few minutes for this. But in general, the lighting system, I know this is beyond the scope of this video, but I just wanted to show it because I had to pause and then come back after a lighting build and explain why it took so long for a lighting build. You're exporting the scene over into the swarm agent, and then it starts doing the light mass, and then it emits photons. So it passes out photons, emits photons from the light sources, and then it collects the photons from bounces and so forth, and then it starts processing the mappings, and then it exports those results, and then it imports those results back into the editor. And that's why it takes so long. So for an example, all this blue up here is the processing the maps, 333 seconds. So, I mean, it took a long time for it to process those maps. 15 seconds, this aspect, caching the irradiance photons, 7 seconds, and then 5 seconds for the emission and so forth. But, I mean, it just takes a while. But that's why I had to pause the video and come back. But anyway, lighting's all done. We're good to go here. We'll go through this and check it out. See, I got all my spawners, my portals, my lighting, everything is good to go. So let's pop in. I have this little doodad out here. Everything is duplicated over. We just rotated, put it on another flat surface. So everything's good to go. I'll go ahead and play it. And boom. It's same configuration. The configuration used for this one is the same used for that one over there. So everything's the same. So I can pop out, escape, I can play again, and we get our randomization, but they're completely configured the same. And I can come back into this one and say, hey, I don't want the M4 being in there. Go over to my details, and I can take out the M4 out of there. So, and I can manipulate these as I want. And for this particular building, I say, okay, well, I want this chair to be moved. I don't want that chair there. I want to move it over here somewhere. Get over there. Pop a rotation around a little bit. And do a little bit more rotation here. Might have to turn off all these to get these things tweaked. Good enough. But because I moved that, we're getting that three objects need to be rebuilt for lighting. But anyway, I've moved the chair, so things have changed a little bit in the environment, so it's not identical to the other one. And that's pretty much how we do it for duplication process. So we're not manually rebuilding this house in another area like 40 times over the size of a huge map. And hopefully that covers everything that was asked. I believe it was collision-based spawning. What is it? I mean, kind of got the point on it. Have to collide with the collision radius to trigger the spawning of a item. Adding a spawner to the world, we've done that. Configured what can spawn, we've done that. Increase, decrease probability, that was the whole thing of adding more elements. The more elements you add to a tier, the more probability there's going to be, and the more randomization there's going to be. Decreasing probability of something and increasing the randomization. You can add multiple, you can add the same thing multiple times. So if I wanted this to have, we're going to do it like this. Let me 7.62 ammo. And let me add a, this doesn't have a booster, I'll add a booster. But if I wanted to have a really, a higher chance than the standard, what it's going to get right now to get an M4 out of that, I would go back through and add another M4 to it. So it's in the system, it's in that array twice. So it increases its chances 50% over what it was before. So that's covered. Adding an item to the spawn system, which is the 9mm, and then adding that into configuring that in, and actually, I will say instead of the booster, we'll put 9mm in there. So that's been covered. Placement, moving spawns, orientation, the rotation over surface. Yeah, we've covered that pretty well. Items are static, no physics. So it looks like everything's covered, and we've moved the scene. The only other thing that I just really want to make clear is, let me actually go over here. Ah, this camera speed. There we go. Let's say take this guy. He's just the M4 guy. Control C V. Duplicated him out. And what I want to do is I just want to rotate this axis here. And yeah. I'll shift it off. I'll shift it this way. See, those are a little above ground. I need to bring that down. I need to take this one and bring it down a little bit. See, those look good. Those look good. See how I'm checking these, make sure that they're, that little horizontal on that crosshair is meeting the surface. Those are good. Got crap light over here. So we're good there. I'm gonna just do a double spawn. There we go, we got some stacking going on. We can actually eject out of this and get down here. And see how right here, because I took that smoothing tool on the terrain, I smoothed this out. It's not, this is the flat surface up here. This isn't flat anymore. So we have that issue where this was actually raised up. This one was raised off the ground. I had to adjust it. You saw that. And I just rotated, I duplicated and rotated it. And now you can cleanly see that the item is spawning somewhat into the ground as well. So we're just going to take both of these and move them up. Hammer speeds, man. Lift these bad boys up. I know this area up here is pretty flat. Yeah, that's pretty flat. Pull this. Pull this one over. This one over here, and I want to drop that down until that, those arrows are a little bit in. Take this one bit in. So there we go. See now they're spawning the way that they should. So, that's the whole point with the rotation and all that. So if I wanted to, I could have something spawn up here on this slope, but then I would have to rotate the spawner so that when, say like an M4, the M4 spawned like in this direction, lengthwise, I would have to tilt it so that it would spawn flush to that surface. And you're not always going to have smooth runs in there, so and then all its purposes, you might end up having something else spawn there for the randomization. It might be something completely different, like a pack of ammo or something that's going to spawn, and in this situation, it might be floating off the ground, so you generally won't see anything being spawned like that. The only time you get weird stuff like that in PUBG in general is when somebody drops an item into the world. They unequip it, they get rid of it, and they just drop it to the world, and then you can get some weird orientations and stuff where you can see things floating off the ground. The same with the body crate. So when somebody dies and the crate gets spawned right there where they died, it's based off the orientation, the transform location of the player. We do a line trace straight down to the ground to get its location. So we shoot a line trace, a raycraft, like basically a hit scan, shoot it to the ground. We make contact with the surface. Where that surface contact was made, we use that location, and then we just spawn the body crate right there. Or the weapon, if we're dropping a weapon. That's how that stuff all works. You can get a good idea of how that works, actually, if you place a nook and you're up on the hillside in the northern part where you have the high hill. You jump off that ledge and then unequip your little apples that you spawn with. They will actually teleport straight down to the ground to where the point where you unequip them. So you can give that a whirl, test it out, and you'll see what's going on with that. It's all line trace based. But anyway, hopefully this video covers everything that I was supposed to cover. If not, drop a comment and let me know, and I'll come back to it and see if I can finish off answering questions that I might have missed. That should do it.